It's Late Night with David Letterman.
He's irreverent, sly, and one of the most influential personalities on the airwaves. David Letterman, a late night icon, a smart aleck kid hiding behind a sense of humor, a local TV hero turned stand-up comic.
He's a marvelous television talent. He's one of the few people that I could watch night after night after night.
Through marriage, divorce, and loss of his father to a heart attack, Letterman made a dream come true. But have his own insecurities gotten in the way of his happiness?
He lives and dies by the energy of that audience. And when they're not up, he feels it's his fault.
His career, his life, his loves. A brush with death and becoming a father for the first time. In this hour, the top 10 TV legend. Ladies and gentlemen,
David Letterman!
This is Headliners and Legends.
Hello, I'm Lester Holt. Even his fans admit that David Letterman is an acquired taste. His quirky sense of humor includes contempt for showbiz in general and TV pretensions in particular. And yet, both personally and professionally, he has had his share of drama. From an uninvited house guest to a potentially fatal heart condition, from becoming a father to an alleged plot to kidnap his son. Even if you're not a fan, stick around as we explore Dave's world.
The program. Thank you for selecting us as your late night viewing entertainment.
David Letterman was born to be on television. For more than 20 years, he's performed his brand of irreverent fun in front of millions of viewers. His show, Late Night with David Letterman, redefined comedy in the 1980s with pioneering humor and David's quick-witted Midwestern style.
What do you want to talk about?
I don't care, but touch me again.
But the road to television fame is long, and his childhood far from the talk show stage he now calls home. It's a story that begins in 1947. David Michael Letterman is born in a quiet Midwestern suburb of Indianapolis. It's a great time to grow up. It's the post-war era, a period of prosperity and opportunity, when suburbs like these offer affordable housing and a safe environment for raising a family.
During the war, this was a big place to build houses because it was easy. You could get your loans. It was a nice place to live, nice place to go.
The 1950s are also a golden age for a new medium called television.
Television became the dominant form of entertainment, replacing both the movies and radio.
Like kids all across America, David is entranced by what he sees on the glowing screen. He dreams of growing up and someday being on TV.
He remembers watching Steve Allen on The Late Night Show and building a microphone with his Erector set just like Steve Allen had on his desk.
Comedians like Allen and Johnny Carson are some of David's favorites.
Johnny Carson!
He told me he used to love to come home from school and watch Carson on Who Do You Trust? And that was really, I think, a huge eye-opener for Dave to see Johnny sort of crack wise with contestants.
But the Indianapolis of David's youth is worlds away from show business. His father, Joe, is a florist, a gregarious man with a knack for comedy.
People knew Joe Letterman as a cut-up, a boisterous man. Dave likes to say when he walked through the room, the lamps would rattle.
His mother, Dorothy, is more straight-laced. She's the one who doles out the discipline in the household.
Well, Dave's a middle child. He has an older sister and a younger sister, and he was the only boy. And I think his mother didn't quite know what to do with him at some level.
Joe Letterman works around the clock, putting in long hours to make ends meet at home. Then, in 1951, when David is just four, his father suffers a heart attack. He survives, but from that moment on, it never leaves David's mind that it could happen again. David grows into a self-conscious, awkward teen. In high school, girls aren't interested in him. He's not popular or particularly athletic. He hides his insecurities behind his sense of humor, which alternates between sarcasm and just plain silliness. At the Atlas supermarket where he works after school, David is known for his practical jokes. One of his favorites is stacking a display of cans so high they actually touch the ceiling.
You couldn't get anything out, you couldn't get anything in, it was just there. and everybody was having a ball with it, laughing.
During school hours, David does find one class that catches his attention, public speaking. Like the father he adores, David is a natural entertainer, and this is a place he can perform.
And now, here's Johnny!
It's not surprising that David is also consumed by what he sees on television, especially comedy. And Johnny Carson, who begins hosting The Tonight Show in 1962, becomes a lifelong role model.
When Johnny succeeded Jack Parr, he became really the benchmark of cool. I mean, to David Letterman, Carson equals cool to this day.
In 1965, David graduates high school and enrolls at Ball State University, about 60 miles from his hometown. From coast to coast, the hippie movement, rock and roll, and protests of all kinds are sweeping campuses. But not at Ball State, where life is more traditional. David fits right in.
Most of the Ball State people back then were from the state of Indiana and not maybe highly attuned to the most current emotional issues of the day.
It's David's first time away from home. He joins a fraternity and does a fair amount of socializing. He also pursues his interest in broadcasting by majoring in television and radio. At the student-run radio station, WBST, he broadcasts daily reports on an imaginary sport he created, Fungo Ball.
Fungo Ball was a 2,000-pound steel ball, and the way you scored was to roll it out of the middle of the stadium through the turnstiles and onto the other team's bus, and that's how you scored points.
Each team is composed of 62 players, 8 forward Sniders, 12 defensive Gormers, and 40 flying Troutmen or Notchers.
His on-air pranks help David build a small campus following. But the station's management is not amused by his satirical style. David is soon fired. The administration may not like his antics, but classmate Michelle Cook does. David is smitten when the attractive 6-foot-tall music major shows interest in him. Michelle is David's first serious girlfriend and quickly becomes his biggest fan.
First time I talked with her, she let me know that her boyfriend was funnier than I was on the radio.
Deeply in love, the college sweethearts elope his senior year. And after graduating in 1969, the couple moves to Indianapolis so David can pursue his broadcasting career. Things are about to start going David's way. But with success will also come a devastating loss. It's 1969 when David Letterman and his new wife return to his hometown of Indianapolis. Through contacts, he finds his first full-time job at local television station Channel 13. There are few TV jobs in a city the size of Indianapolis, and finding one is quite a coup for the 21-year-old. David is assigned to host not one, but two unusual TV shows. Clover Power is a Saturday afternoon kids show sponsored by the 4-H Club. David can't resist infusing the show with his sardonic style.
Well, hi. We've been waiting for you folks. And welcome to Clover Power for another outstanding week. Have we got the Power Pack Dynamite Big Time all-around histrionic extravaganza for you folks today.
His other show is an after-hours B-movie program called Freeze-Dried Movies.
Well, tonight's movie is, of course, Dr. Mabuse versus Scotland Yard, which is, of course, 3 feet 6 inches opposed to the American Yard, which is 3 feet even. Of course, this being the universal measurement signal for 3 feet even.
Hey, you!
But it's as the station's weekend weatherman that David gains real notoriety. For David, the weather is the perfect vehicle to showcase his quick wit.
Of little importance once you take a look at the cloud cover photograph made earlier of the United States today, and I think you'll see that once again we've fallen to the prey of political dirty dealings. The higher-ups have removed the border between Indiana and Ohio, making it one giant state. Personally, I'm against it.
For almost 4 years, David's offbeat approach to broadcasting keeps him thriving professionally. But at home, without warning, at the age of 57, David's father suffers another heart attack. This time, it's fatal. David is devastated.
His father just walked into the flower shop one day and keeled over and was dead. And I think it just left this gaping hole in his life, but it also created this fear of what's lurking around the corner.
I know that it was a personal loss in his life. It was a kind of mourning that he did very personally and very privately.
David loses himself in his work, but by now, TV weather has become too small a form for his talent.
I did the weather, and then I got bored with occluded fronts. I didn't see much humor there.
Yeah.
And so the home viewers, really, they're not up for a lot of funny stuff in the weather, so I began to get a little frustrated.
At the same time, Jane Pauley, another fresh-faced broadcaster, is making a name for herself on the Indianapolis airwaves. It's not until years later that the two would become friends.
I'm Jane Pauley reporting at the supermarket.
In 1974, David decides to leave television and try his hand at radio. He lands a job at station WNTS, where he hosts an afternoon drive-time show. It's here that David develops a reputation for the outrageous.
One of the bits that he did on that program was reporting that the Soldiers and Sailors Monument at Monument Circle in downtown Indianapolis had been sold by the City Fathers of Indianapolis to the island of Guam. The island of Guam was going to spray paint it green and use it as a giant asparagus.
But David's audience doesn't always appreciate his on-air humor. Feeling discouraged, he sets his sights on becoming a comedy writer in Hollywood. But in the back of his mind, David dreams of performing his material in an arena like The Tonight Show.
I came out as a writer because it's easier to tell people in Indiana you're going to Hollywood to become a writer as opposed to telling them you're going to become a comedian.
Saying to somebody, I'm going to go to Hollywood and be a comedian, would be like saying, when I grow up, I'm going to be a cowboy. And Dave just didn't want to do that, so he left us without that information.
In the spring of 1975, David finds the courage to load his red pickup truck, and together with his wife, Michelle, they leave everything they know for the City of Angels. Still, he clings to the notion that he can come back home if things don't work out.
I was confident that I could go back to Indianapolis or some other comparable broadcasting market and, you know, without a great deal of difficulty, probably get another job.
To David's surprise, he quickly finds an audience for his comedy, but not as a writer.
He was there a very short time when he decided he would throw caution to the wind and he would go to the Comedy Store, which was the club in L.A. that had basically become the comedy haven.
It was the only comedy club out here. It was the comedy club in those days, the only place where ABC, NBC, CBS would come and see you.
David Letterman.
The shy Midwesterner is more than a little intimidated his first time out. But once he ascends the lighted stage, David comes alive.
And on the back of the can of Gillette Foamy in red letters, it says, do not spray shaving cream toward open flame. Thank God they finally had the sense to put that warning on there, huh?
When I first met David Letterman, first of all, he was very shy about going on stage, almost terrified. And then he'd get up there and he'd be very funny.
How many times have we all been seriously injured after you go to the trouble to build a roaring fire in the bathroom sink?
He was a profoundly sarcastic demeanor, and I think that combined with his sort of Midwestern, homespun, you know, innocence to some degree, was sort of a potent combination.
David's act begins to gain popularity, but he still lacks training. He looks to a more experienced comedian for direction. His name is Jay Leno. Still in his 20s, Leno is already one of the most talked about comics around.
Leno was a big influence in Dave's stand-up comedy. He really appreciated and admired the way Jay delivered jokes, the way Jay set up jokes and paid off.
Before long, David becomes skilled at some of Leno's basic techniques and begins retailoring his own act. But as David's career starts to come together, his marriage begins to fall apart. The showbiz life is too enticing for the young comedian, and he begins to spend more and more time away from home.
He was working all night and she was working all day, and they kind of grew apart.
After 8 years of marriage, David and Michelle divorce in 1977. But David won't be alone for long. He'll soon meet another woman, and with her help, David's career will skyrocket. It's 1977, and David Letterman and his wife of 8 years have just split up. He must now fend for himself in the fast-paced world of show business. At the same time, David's career is picking up momentum. He signs with a high-powered agent and writes material for legendary comedians Bob Hope and Paul Lynn.
I think Dave was the first guy who secretly thought that maybe stand-up was a way to another place.
And for David, that place is television. He's soon making TV appearances on game shows and comedy programs like the 60 Minutes parody, Peeping Times.
Just exactly. Why are you making these phony footprints?
Well, I'm helping to keep Bigfoot alive.
Why would you want to do that?
Well, in our little town of Yule, here. Hi, Luke.
Billy.
In our little town of Yule here in the state of Washington, you know, we all work together.
He also continues performing stand-up as a way to get noticed. One night, while on stage at the Comedy Store, he attracts the attention of a fellow comedian, a woman named Meryl Marco.
He said, did you ever meet a girl who you thought was as smart and funny as you? And I said, geez, I don't know. And he was talking about Meryl.
Meryl is a Berkeley graduate who taught art before switching to stand-up. She is as worldly as David is provincial. They seem an unlikely pair, but a shared sense of humor forms the basis for a personal relationship that quickly becomes professional.
She just realized, boy, his style works with my material really well, and so she started giving him her jokes, which wound up being sort of the story of their lives. And as Dave progressed, she was the true woman behind the man.
So, with Meryl's help, David refines his act and plots to get an invitation to perform on the show hosted by his childhood idol, Johnny Carson.
He represents American television to me, and I've watched him, liked him, admired him. I've been in awe of him all his career.
Everybody was out at the Comedy Store trying to get on at the Comedy Store first, and then second of all, once you got on and you developed your act, trying to get the Tonight Show to come and see you.
Carson's people do see David's act, and they're impressed. They ask him to appear on the show that, until now, David's only dreamed about, The Tonight Show.
I was with him when The Tonight Show first kind of came up to him and approached him. And they said, geez, I'd like to get you on the show. And then he had this answer. He said, I would consider, you know, a great honor to be able to come on and, you know, maybe make a few people on your show laugh or whatever it was he said. It was something that you could tell he'd had going on, a script that he had written a long time ago.
He confides to Meryl that his ambitions go far beyond just performing his stand-up routine.
He opened up to Meryl in a way he'd never opened up to anyone before. And he told her, yes, it was his dream, and he would someday be the host of The Tonight Show.
For the moment, David is content to focus on his upcoming appearance. The way he sees it, this could be his big break or the end of his career.
He's saying to me, after tonight, I'm getting my pickup truck, drive back to Indianapolis, you know. He was always insecure.
Despite his fears, David appears on the empty stage to face millions of television viewers. To everyone who sees him, one thing is clear. David Letterman is a star.
I'm looking at this can, and it says on there, for the dog that suffers constipation. But you know, the way I look at it, if your dog is constipated, why screw up a good thing, huh? That was the biggest thrill for me, even today. Nothing was more exciting to me or as satisfying as appearing on that program with Johnny.
Carson immediately connects with David's Midwestern sensibility. In the shortest warm-up in Tonight Show history, David begins guest hosting after just two more appearances. He'll take Carson's chair more than 20 times over the next few years. But it's not David's TV appearances that catch the eye of NBC president Fred Silverman. It's a last-minute performance at a charity function that gets Silverman thinking about giving David his own show. NBC is looking to compete against the usual morning fare of game shows and sitcom reruns with a folksy talk show format to appeal to housewives. What they get is the David Letterman Show.
Pretty much all you need for a show, isn't it? The Bible. No, I'm sorry, it's not the Bible.
When I first saw him do his morning show, I was attracted to the fact that he seemed unlike other broadcasters. He seemed like he didn't belong there, that he was talking with a regular person's voice on television.
David's girlfriend Meryl comes on board as the show's head writer and producer. The skits she writes take David and his unique sensibility outside the studio.
Tom Snyder's dressing room. Let's just see if Mr. Snyder is in. Come on in, if you will. Why, it's almost like a shrine in here. It's breathtaking, ladies and gentlemen. Excuse me.
Good morning.
What is your name, sir?
My name is Brian.
Brian, how are you? And you work for Mr. Snyder?
Yes, I do.
What do you do?
I prepare cocktails
for Mr. Snyder. Come on in, let's see.
Can't we do?
Oh, I really shouldn't, but what the heck.
They also come up with a new concept that will become a David Letterman classic, Stupid Pet Tricks, inspired by David and Merrill's own beloved canines. These whimsical, inane stunts are always a crowd pleaser. Unfortunately, the David Letterman show is inundated with problems, not the least of which is its early morning time slot.
The show and I was an immediate disaster. I mean, it's just his brands of humor just didn't work in the morning with the housewives who were looking at television at that point in time.
After only a few months on the air, affiliates start dropping Letterman. Then, the fateful call comes on September 26, 1980. The David Letterman show is canceled. Although the show's ratings are abysmal, by the time the last show airs, David Letterman has a cult following and critical acclaim, winning Dave and Merrill 2 Emmys for their efforts. But David isn't satisfied with the praise. His one chance at hosting his own network show has failed miserably. He's certain he will never work again. What he doesn't know is that he will soon get another break, and this one will make him a star.
Headliners and legends will return in a moment.
The late 1970s, frequent guest shots for Johnny Carson on The Tonight Show make David Letterman a comer. But cancellation of his own daytime network show sends him into a deep funk. Though still under contract at Good Money, Letterman retreats into the isolation of home. It's not in his character to seek the favor of anyone, be it audience or network press.
Somebody asked former President Ford if the nearly 3 years that he spent in the White House were his most difficult 3 years, and he said, no, actually, he spent his most difficult 3 years in the fourth grade. So.
During the next few years, David works for NBC under a lucrative holding contract and does little more than occasionally guest host for Johnny Carson.
The purpose of the contract is to get a show that would be a late night show. But at this point, there are no late night openings, so I'm not optimistic for that to come through. But in the meantime, I'll certainly be happy to take their money.
Then, in November of 1981, NBC cancels the long-running Tomorrow with Tom Snyder, opening up the coveted 12:30 time slot after Carson. NBC executives think it's perfect for David's unusual brand of humor.
Fortunately, I was very, very lucky. I have been as lucky as anybody can get in show business and television because I got another chance.
And now, a man who shouldn't be up this late, David Letterman!
His second chance comes on February 1st, 1982. While most of America is sound asleep, David makes a grand entrance on the NBC Studio 6A stage.
I'm very excited about this new show, and it's a big 3 or 4 days for NBC.
Late Night is a talk show with a twist. It's unpredictable, original, and for a young audience bored with the formulaic approach to TV, it's liberating. David's first guest is comedian Bill Murray.
Let's get physical, I wanna get physical.
It's safe to say that no one has ever seen anything quite like Late Night with David Letterman.
Dancing with stage managers is now routine. In those days, it was something.
David again enlists the talents of his girlfriend, Meryl Marco, as his head writer. They bring back viewer favorites like Stupid Pet Tricks and comic excursions outside the studio.
The name of the store is Just Bulbs, and that's exactly what we sell, Just Bulbs.
Okay, so besides bulbs, what do you have here?
Nothing.
How about shades? Could you get shades here?
No, we are Just Bulbs. If you want shades, maybe go a place called Just Shades.
We sell nothing but lampshades at discount prices.
What is the name of the store?
Just Shades.
And what can you get in here?
What can you get in here?
Only Shades.
Late Night surpasses everyone's expectations. Grabbing a loyal college audience and surprising ratings, the show looks like a winner.
NBC gave us a big cake and a party after 100 shows, and that felt like, oh, made it. And then another cake and a party after 200 shows, and I think the cakes and the parties pretty much stopped.
But with success comes the pressure to keep succeeding, and no one feels that burden more than David.
It was always like, we're going to be canceled, we're going to fail, if the show, you know, if next week's show isn't funny, we'll be off the air. That's what he would say, because the self-doubt never went away.
David's feelings of anxiety affect his relationship with Meryl. The show consumes both their lives. And for Meryl, trying to live up to David's high expectations is not easy.
She just was tremendous at coming up with new, fresh ideas. Although she did feel like she was battered by the rejection, because Dave rejected so many of them.
But despite the strain behind the scenes, David's quirky humor continues to push the limits of late night.
He wanted to see what could we do in television. Let's go behind the scenes. Let's go outside. Let's just do something with a camera that we haven't seen before. Let's have recurring crazy characters, like a guy living under the seats.
Dave?
Oh, yeah. Yes, sir. What can I do for you?
Do you have any A1 sauce?
But David never hears the applause. As late night becomes more popular, David becomes increasingly self-critical.
He'd throw things in his office when he was angry, and, you know, he was volatile about the show. But that was because he was a perfectionist. He wanted the show to be great every night.
Though late night generally fares well with critics, David is repeatedly accused of being mean-spirited. His reputation for undiplomatic pander leads to some awkward exchanges.
No, because I thought that I would never want to do this show with you.
Now, why? Now, let's explore this a little. Why? Because you thought I was...
An ass.
Cher's remark surprises David. He knows what people say about him, but he doesn't view himself as malicious and defends himself publicly on NBC's Today Show.
If there's going to be some sort of incendiary display, I'll usually wait for the other person to start. You know, there's nothing premeditated about this. There's no malice involved here. We're not looking to be mean or hurtful.
David does get along with many of his guests. One of his favorites is fellow Hoosier Jane Pauley. On Late Night, the prominent journalist gets the chance to have some fun.
Come on, don't you want to just say one thing? Say, I love you, Willard. Yeah. Willard, lose some weight. Just something. I say hi. Hello.
It's sure been fun.
Another one of David's frequent guests is his old friend, Jay Leno. David is loyal to the comedian who helped him develop his early act.
He let Jay do his comedy, you know, and it brought Jay out. It made Jay a national figure being on that show.
Late Night's ratings are the highest ever when General Electric acquires NBC in 1986, but David feels neglected under NBC's new management, and as always, shares his rising discontent with his audience.
One of the more hilarious things he did, soon after GE took over NBC, he and his video crew went to Connecticut to the GE headquarters.
And we thought, what the heck, let's just drop in and, say hello.
Hi, how are you? I'm Dave Letterman. Nice to meet you.
What is your name?
I'm going to ask you to turn the cameras off, please.
Okay, we just wanted to drop off this basket of fruit.
Okay. Would you cut the cameras, please?
It's a gesture of goodwill.
Will you cut the cameras, please?
You have to talk to the director right over there, Mr. Green.
It was very funny, but it sort of underscored his outsider status.
Meanwhile, behind the scenes, NBC is taking notice of Jay Leno. In 1987, Leno is made tonight's permanent guest host.
At no point did David ever say, whoa, see, this guy's getting, you know, kind of popular or too big, or let's scale back his appearances, or anything of that nature. He was always very gracious.
David is too absorbed by the demands of late night to notice anything else. He barely has time for his girlfriend of 8 years, Meryl Marco.
Every night they drive home together to Connecticut, and he'd say, this didn't work, and I'm unhappy, and he'd be disappointed in the show, and, you know, it just put tremendous strain on the relationship, and eventually it broke.
Meryl leaves the show for good in 1986. Her relationship with David ends a few years later. Her departure breaks up a partnership that produced some of the decade's most groundbreaking comedy. By the late 80s, Late Night has made David a celebrity, but he doesn't embrace showbiz life. In fact, his lifestyle is quite solitary.
You don't get much of a chance to see him off the show. And I've kind of like made a joke out of that, saying, I want to be your friend. We've got to spend time together. Let me come over and watch football with you or something.
But David is spending time dating a young NBC staffer named Regina Lasco. But it's his relationship with another woman that will soon make headlines. By 1988, Late Night with David Letterman is in its sixth season and more popular than ever. David celebrates the show's long run with an anniversary special at New York's renowned Radio City Music Hall.
What we've done here, we've come into the most famous theater, the most beautiful theatrical structure in the world, and overnight we've turned it into a lousy drive-in. Thank you.
Although David is everyone's pal on stage, off stage he is extremely guarded about his personal life. Then, without warning, David suddenly finds himself being stalked by a mentally ill woman named Margaret Ray. His personal life is now exposed to all.
He found her in the grounds, he found her at the pool, he found various places in the house, and one night he's actually asleep in bed. He was in bed with his girlfriend, and he's like, what is that? And he looks in the hall, and she's in the house. She's walking around the house.
Ray is arrested 8 times for trespassing and related offenses. Eventually, like most things in David's life, Ray becomes part of his act.
In my wallet, I carry a card that says right there, it has my name and stuff, and it says, in case of an emergency, notify the stranger living in my house. So that had to be that I would have been.
By 1991, a surprise announcement cast David in the spotlight for a different reason. Johnny Carson, who has hosted The Tonight Show for almost 3 decades, is retiring.
Somewhere very early in his remarks, he says, you know, and as people know, this is going to be my last year. Well, and he continues to talk, and everyone in the room starts looking around like, what did he say?
That same night, Carson appears on Late Night with David Letterman. Johnny's first comment to David is ripe with assumptions about his future.
And, you know, Ed McMahon, our good friend, could not be here. Yeah. But it seems, David, that you are the $1 million winner.
Oh, my God! I've won $1 million!
Believed to be heir apparent to Johnny's throne, David waits to hear from his NBC employers. What David doesn't know is a decision has already been made. NBC has offered the job to Jay Leno. This news puts into motion one of the biggest battles in late-night TV history.
7 days earlier, NBC had concluded a deal with Leno, firmly committing to him that whenever Johnny quit, he would get the show.
When David reads about Leno's succession in the newspaper, he is stunned. He shouldn't be. Unlike David, Leno is polished and accessible.
It was a no-brainer. It was a slam dunk. David was not a team player when he was on Late Night. If NBC said, David, would you come and be the master of ceremonies for our NBC affiliates dinner, he'd say no. And Jay shakes hands with everybody. You want Jay to come to the affiliates dinner, Jay will not only go to the affiliates dinner, he'll stay at the house with him if you want.
Because he was not a political animal, Letterman sort of set himself up for losing a job that he had deserved, that he had won and earned.
David decides to fight back. He begins to leverage his popularity by seeking outside offers.
Soon Dave had offers from ABC, Fox, CBS, and a number of studios and syndication. Everybody wants him. He has huge offers on the table.
But it's a proposal from CBS that David finds the most interesting. The network reportedly offers him between $14 and $16 million a year and the opportunity to own his program. And that's not all. CBS promises to put him up against Jay Leno's Tonight Show. Not surprisingly, NBC soon enters the fray. Losing David to CBS would force the network and the Tonight Show to compete against the very star they created. Finally, in January of 1993, NBC reportedly offers him The Tonight Show. But there's a catch. They want David to wait another 17 months for the job.
They wanted to finish Leno's contract and then offer it to Dave. But it was like a half-baked offer because, as many of Dave's associates told him, if Leno starts to succeed, they're going to weasel out of this deal.
He decides to seek the advice of the one person who values The Tonight Show as much as he does.
It almost seems like it's fiction that he did this, but he did call Johnny Carson and ask Johnny, what would you do, Johnny? And Johnny said, okay, if you're asking me what I'd do, I'd walk.
Taking Carson's advice, David turns his back on NBC and accepts CBS's offer.
And I want to thank them for their support, and also I would like to thank them for their generosity because...
When the deal is officially announced on January 14, 1993, it's a national news story.
This deal certainly would have put a smile on Jack Benny's face. Even in the condition he's in now, he would have...
David says his final goodbyes on June 25th, 1993. He makes it an occasion to perform one last joke at NBC's expense.
Welcome to the program, ladies and gentlemen. You are looking at a very excited, very happy man. Listen to this. Earlier today, for the first time, NBC named me Employee of the Month.
2 months later, David will take on the biggest challenge of his career, competing for the title King of Late Night Television. 1993 is a year of great change for David Letterman. After 13 years at NBC, David will go head-to-head with The Tonight Show's new host, Jay Leno. It's hyped as a clash of the titans.
I think it'll be exciting once we go against each other. I think we'll be watching both shows on a nightly basis, and I think it'll make our show better. I think it'll make his show better. I mean, you're always better when there's competition.
The day finally arrives on August 30th, 1993. Scores of David's fans line up outside the studio, waiting to be part of television history, the premiere of CBS's Late Show with David Letterman. When David walks out on stage for the first time, he emanates an aura of a man in charge, ready to assume the mantle King of Late Night.
If you think about it, all I really did was take the summer off.
He was sort of a new man when he stepped on that stage at the Ed Sullivan Theater the first time. He was a man coated in confidence. He looked like a million bucks.
For good luck, Bill Murray is booked as David's first guest, just as he was on Late Night. David and Jay are not the only ones competing for the 11:30 audience. Dubbed by the press as the Late Night Wars, David is also pitted against comedians Arsenio Hall and Chevy Chase. But David quickly overwhelms all competition. Chase's show is canceled after just 6 weeks, and the Arsenio Hall show is gone within the year. Late Show even dominates Leno. For nearly 2 years, David tops an embarrassed NBC in the ratings. In 1994, David gets his mother into the act as Late Show's correspondent for the 1994 Olympics in Norway. Dorothy Letterman's deadpan attitude wins the hearts of viewers coast to coast.
And the mother turned out to be an extremely popular figure, and they would use her during sweet months because she was so effective.
By 1995, the tide starts to turn. On July 10th, an appearance by Hugh Grant propels Jay into the lead for the first time since Late Show's premiere.
There was a very famous episode where Hugh Grant got arrested and everybody wondered what was going on with him, and he had already been booked on The Tonight Show, so he got to talk about it for the first time on Jay's show, and he got an enormous rating that night.
The grind of competing against Leno every night is beginning to wear David down. He's not getting much help from CBS's primetime lineup either.
They had no shows working in primetime. And, you know, initially you could see the difference on Thursday night because NBC had ER on.
The result is Late Show ratings that not only lag behind The Tonight Show, but often behind ABC's Nightline. Then, in the year 2000, David's troubles reach far beyond his sagging ratings. On January 14th, David announces that he's going in that night for tests on his heart.
Regis. They go right up inside your...
In your groin muscle.
Yeah.
They run it right up your groin.
Right, very close to your deal.
He never, ever really does tell you much about his personal life. And here was about as personal as you can get. You know, a guy with heart disease and worried about it.
The next day, it's all over the news. David Letterman has undergone emergency heart surgery.
Doctors say the operation went smoothly, and Letterman, who is 52 years old, should make a rapid recovery.
5 weeks later, on February 21st, a gaunt David takes the stage. The entire show revolves around what everyone is talking about, David's health.
My father dropped dead when he was in his mid-50s, and I kind of had a hunch that I was going to have to deal with this one day, and I just thought, thank God I'm dealing with it now and taking care of it.
As David introduces the medical team that saved his life, something extraordinary happens. He becomes emotional on the air.
So it was 5 weeks ago today that these men and women right here saved my life. And
I think he revealed a softer, sentimental side to him. Yeah, David Letterman loves his life. And we all found out that night.
That evening, the program receives its highest rating in 6 years. And for the first time, David openly jokes about being passed over for the one job he has coveted most of his life.
One thing, bypass surgery, it's when doctors surgically create new blood flow to your heart. Bypass surgery. A bypass is what happened to me when I didn't get the Tonight Show.
In November 2003, David again shares big news with his audience. At the age of 56, David is a dad. He and longtime girlfriend Regina Lasko welcome a son they name Harry Joseph, after David's father. The new family experiences a close call in March 2005, when police uncover an alleged plot to kidnap Harry. Authorities apprehend Kelly Frank, who worked as a painter at Letterman's ranch in Montana. Frank makes a deal with prosecutors and pleads guilty to obstruction and felony theft. He's sentenced to 10 years in prison. On his show, David thanks law enforcement, but in true Letterman fashion, he also jokes about it.
And they're completely serious and deadly earnest, and you don't want to cross them, don't even poke them.
No.
David Letterman has redefined comedy and has taken his place alongside legendary broadcasters of days past.
Arthur Godfrey, Ed Sullivan, David Letterman, they're all great television guys who have made their mark on this business, changed this business.
David is a comedic genius, and if you look at what role he's had on television, on two major networks, he truly does fall into the same line of people like Milton Berle and Jack Benny and Bob Hope. He's in the pantheon.
David Letterman's childhood idol was Johnny Carson. When Carson passed away in January 2005, Letterman dedicated his entire show to his mentor, even delivering a monologue composed entirely of jokes written by Carson in his final months. But Letterman turned very serious when he said, quote, I owe everything in my professional career, whatever success we've attained, to Johnny Carson. I'm Lester Holt. Thanks for watching.